Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. I begin in the name of Allah, the All-Beneficent, the All-Merciful. The title of the book is The Roots of Religion, Chapter 25, The Spiritual Guidance of the Imam. The life of the Prophet as well as his deeds are a sure demonstration of the basic project of Islam. He was both the political leader and the social governor of the Muslims and the bringer of the revelation, who delivered the commands and laws of Islam from Allah, employing them in the field of Islamic government. His actions were the manifestations of the law, his behavior pure virtue, and his instructions the guide and leadership of a strong and wise man. He was not content merely to counsel and advise, but rather proceeded to establish a model society founded on true justice. Since Islam also gives mundane sanction to the securing of satisfaction within the society, this does not mean that it refers the punishment of those who damage social happiness with their criminality to another time. For in this case too, it carries out the prescribed punishment for these people in this world also. So government and leadership together form the work of this great man. But of course, Islam has distinction over others, worldly systems of governments, that together with this side of the coin, it always looks to the being of each individual, and it always recommends the keeping pace of Islamic laws with the pursuit of spiritual and human virtues. This latter it is which today within civilizations is left to oblivion, and gradually the festering and petrifying results of this are seen. The cause of this is the forgetting of humanitarianism, spirituality, and the future life. However, Islam has laid a special emphasis to this point, and the leadership has always established the basis of its philosophy on the spiritual training of mankind. The majority of men are unaware of the reality of their own exalted human essence, since it is so subtle and delicate that it is only seen by the clear-sighted. So, in the understanding of the ordinary man, this verdant land of the existence of each human being is situated in an area far from his cogitation and ideation, and he cannot conceive of this land, let alone be a leader towards it. How can man, who after passing of centuries and centuries has still not come to understand even half of the physical actions and reactions that govern his body, expect to know its metaphysical side, or give guidance and a way to reach that far objective? So without any dispute, the leader to this land must be someone the essence of whose existence is in union with the metaphysical world, and who is in relation with and knows this terrain from being a traveller in its own and unknown valleys. Till you have not travelled, how can you be a guide? Now, is it right that we should wash our hands of our spiritual genius and sublime essence of man, and take him to be equal of a beast and leave him in the world of appetites and the libido? No, never. This is not the reality of man's great status. Man with the spiritual and celestial needs and with the special genius which God has placed in his character is the masterpiece of creation and the son of the world of created things. This is why he takes his place like the world illuminating sun in heights beyond reach, and sheds his warmth and the heat on all quarters of the world like the rays of the sun. Since it has been determined thus, man is no mere wanderer in the order of creation. He is a small peck, but the great divine sun shines on him and regards him with his special favors out of all creation. We can see the results of this favor from God to man along the length of human history in his sending of the prophets. God sent the prophets on the basis of this love and favor so that they might lead men and take their great but turbulent spirit to the shore of that great salvation and eminence. The Holy Quran refers to this reality in numerous verses. As for instances, when Prophet Ibrahim, peace be upon him, asks God, as mentioned in the Quran, رَبَّنَا وَبَعَثْ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ يَتْلُو عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ آيَاتِكَ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ Innaka antal azizul hakim. And our Lord, do thou send them among them a messenger, one of them who shall recite to them thy signs and teach them the book and the wisdom and purify them. Thou art the Almighty and the All-Wise. Surah Baqarah, Surah 2, verse 129. In this verse, we see clearly that apart from knowledge and wisdom and guidance, the purification of the soul, which is the same as spiritual training, is counted as one of the essentials of calling of the prophets. In the school of the illustrious prophet, his followers benefit from this special training and participate in the following of a dazzling and wondrous path of perfection. Salman al-Farsi, Abu Dhar al-Ghafari, Miqdad al-Aswad, Ammar al-Yasir, Uwais al-Qarani, and many others are amongst this distinguished group. Their beings were pure and righteous springs. They were purified from all badness. They wished for nothing apart from Allah and saw nothing apart from Him. Only Allah ruled in their beings, throughout their souls, hearts, spirits and bodies. Similarly, virtue and the refining of the spirit is not a superfluous matter of mere formality that we should be indifferent to and set apart from all other matters of life, to be attended to only when we feel like it or at our leisure. No virtue is the builder of life and a part of it, even much more important than it. For according to the testimony of wisdom in the senses, the great qualities of spiritual virtue and purity are so immense and so fathomless that man can with its protection leave his form and mold and reach to the spiritual life and realize the high reality of his humaneness till he sees that which is beyond his sight. Indications of spiritual life in Islam. As the Quran states, مَنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٍ فَلَنُحْيَيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبًا. And whoever does a right deed, righteous deed, be it a male or a female, a believer, we shall surely give him a goodly life. Surah An-Nahl, Surah 16, verse 97. In another verse, the Quran states, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اسْتَجِيبُوا لِلَّهِ وَلِلرَّسُولِ إِذَا دَعَاكُمْ لِمَا يُحْيِيكُمْ وَعَلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَحُولُ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَقَلْبِهِ وَأَنَّهُ إِلَيْهِ تُحْشَرُونَ. O you who believe, respond to Allah and the Messenger when He calls you to that which will give you life. Surah Anfal, Surah 8, verse 24. It is obvious that the life which is mentioned in the above verses is not the ordinary life. It is nothing but the spiritual life, virtuous human existence which can only be obtained from the way of righteous action and refinement of the soul. How is the spiritual life found? As with other phenomena, the finding of the spiritual life requires the fulfillment of certain conditions. The spiritual life is the fruit of man's behavior and deeds. Naturally, that behavior and those deeds which are formed by true and righteous training, which are taught by celestial teachings. The command and prohibition of God, which we call the Sharia, stand in exact correspondence with the truths and realities of the world of creation and Genesis. Since we are unaware of the truths of the universe, its workings, its ins and outs, and its happening for our intellects, it's insufficient. We are ignorant of the behavior which builds our spiritual lives. But the Imam alayhi salam, peace be upon them, reveals these high truths and superior workings to man like a wise and loving teacher with many clear explanations so that we may become filled with bliss and reach to the spiritual life. So the way of Islam is the sum total of realities and instructions which are greater than our ordinary understanding and which Allah has explained by means of the Prophet and his pure, unsullied representatives so that the spiritual life may take root within us and assure us of eternal bliss. Now, if we obey the command, salvation will be ours. If not, it is our loss. Just like a child who is placed under instruction, who hears only command and prohibition from his instructor, and who does what is required of him without asking why. Although he does not understand in the depths of the matter what it means, he will, after the passing of the days of his education, live a life of contentment because of the virtue and praiseworthy ways of action, which were brought into action within him. However, if he revolts against carrying out the orders of his instructors, it will result in inestimable loss to him. Life guidance. Now let us see who is the guarantee for this spiritual life and its perfection, which surely needs a guidance. Will he be found among ordinary men, or will he be someone who speaks with sureness and dependability, who is in his behavior from error immaculate, and he himself stand on the pinnacle of the spiritual life? Until God guides someone completely himself, he does not entrust to him the duty of guiding others. As mentioned in the Quran, أَفَمَنْ يَهْدِي إِلَى الْحَقِّ أَحَقُّ أَنْ يُتَّبَعَ أَمَّنْ لَا يَهْدِي إِلَّا أَنْ يُهْدَى فَمَا لَكُمْ كَيْفَ تَحْكُمُونَ. Allah, he guides to the truth, and which is worthier to be followed. He who guides to the truth, or he who guides not unless he is guided. What ails you? How you act? Surah Yunus, Surah 10, verse 35. More particularly, the imamat is not the leadership in ordinary sense, for this is the duty of every Muslim and not confined to the imam. The meaning of guidance here is esoteric guidance, and those who have not found the spiritual life, to whom the realities of the universe have not been revealed, cannot take on this kind of leadership. By looking into the verses of the Quran which speak of the imamat and guidance, we can see that everywhere that imamat is mentioned, the subject of guidance is also mentioned in commentary and explanation. What is spiritual guidance? The imam, besides being an educator in the commands of Islam, the exotic side is also the leader in the esoteric of Islam. He is the wall. That is to say, he takes man through the inner way, the man who has the predisposition and the worthiness, and leads him towards perfection. This guidance, because it is carried out on the basis of spiritual blessing and inner stations, is called esoteric guidance. Esoteric guidance is a superior station which the great prophets reached after the station of prophethood. Thus, Prophet Ibrahim, peace be upon him, after he had been made a prophet, was raised by God to the station of esoteric guidance. As the Quran states, Inni ja'iluka linnasi imama. Verily, I make you an imam for mankind. Surah Baqarah, Surah 2, verse 124. When he had reached the station of wilayat and esoteric guidance, the imam can apply himself to great works which seem miraculous or impossible from the point of view of ordinary people. The Holy Quran tells how Asif ibn Barkhiya, one of the counselors of Prophet Sulaiman, peace be upon him, known in the biblical language as Solomon, could cause the throne of the Queen of Saba to come before Prophet Sulaiman ahead of her own arrival, in a time shorter than the blinking of an eye, since he had a certain dominance over the supernatural world and could take away the shutters covering the facts and realities of this world. Our sinless leaders, the imams, peace be upon them all, are situated on a level greater and higher than Asif. The proof of this is the authoritative and documented histories of the narrators, where we find many stories of the spiritual guidance and the inner walayat of our imams. Therefore, the imam, since he is in the highest stage of spiritual life, has a kind of spiritual guidance and charisma which can have an effect on the hearts of worthy people and cause a transformation in them, attracting them towards perfection. We can read in histories about the states and conditions of groups of followers of the imams and how they illuminated their times with their brilliance. The man from Damascus. Ali ibn Khalid was a Zaydi, that is, he did not accept any of the Imam after the fourth Imam, Imam Ali ibn al-Husayn Zain al-Abidin, peace be upon him. And he lived in the time of the ninth Imam, Imam Muhammad ibn Ali al-Taqi, peace be upon him. He related that he had been in Samarra and he was informed that a man had been brought from Damascus to that place in captivity as a prisoner who claimed to be a prophet. Ali ibn Khalid went to see him and asked him to relate his story. "I was busy in worship," he began, "at the place which they say is the resting place of the pure head of the noble martyr, Imam Hussein, peace be upon him. One night a man suddenly appeared in front of me and told me to stand up. I stood up despite myself and went a short way with him when I found myself in the mosque at Kufa. He asked me if I knew the mosque and I said that I did. It was the mosque of Kufa. He prayed and I prayed with him and then we set out again. We had gone no distance at all when I noticed the mosque of Medina. He asked for the blessings of the Prophet of Allah and we both prayed there. Then we left and set out once more. Then I noticed we were in Makkah. We circumambulated the Kaaba, left it and then arrived at our original place, Damascus, after no time at all. Then that person vanished from my sight. A slight breeze came and brushed my face and went. A year after that adventure, I saw the very same man. I became greatly gladdened. He took me on the same journey and like the first time, we visited all those places fully aware. But when he wanted to leave me, I said to him, I beseech you, who have such a great power as I see you, tell me your name. He said, I am Muhammad ibn Ali ibn Musa ibn Jafar. He was the ninth Imam. Now I proceed to tell everyone I met of this extraordinary event till news reached Muhammad ibn Malik Zayyad. He ordered that I be arrested and accused of posing as a prophet. And now, as you see, I am in prison. Ali ibn Khalid asked him if he wanted him to write to Muhammad ibn Abdul Malik about his case. The man told him to write, so he wrote, but in his answer, Ibn Abdul Malik wrote, tell him that he can escape from his prison if he wants, in the same way as he went in the night from Damascus to Kufa and from there to Medina and Makkah and then back again to Damascus. Ibn Khalid was most depressed by this answer. In the morning, he went to the prison to give the man the answer, but he saw there were many soldiers and a crowd of people coming and going around the prison, so he asked what had happened. They told him that the prisoner who had claimed to be a prophet had escaped from the prison. No one knew how he had escaped, by going through the ground or by flying. Ali ibn Khalid said, when I saw this, I left my own Zaydi creed and became a follower of Imam Muhammad Taqi, the ninth Imam. Maisam al-Tammar or Misam al-Tammar. Imam Ali, peace be upon him, chief among those who forbear, brought and freed Maisam. He asked him what his name was. Salim, he replied. But I heard from the Prophet that your name, your true name is Maisam, said the Imam. Misam said, he spoke correctly and you speak correctly. My name, my true name is Maisam. Then stay with the name of the Prophet called you by and leave the other name. In this way, Imam Ali, peace be upon him, brought and freed the slave, but he cast the noose of love around his neck so that he remained with him up to the last moment of his life. Even death could not break this link. Maisam was a free man who had amazing ability and he gradually attained great honor in the school of Imam Ali, peace be upon him, and took his place among the group of friends of Imam Ali. He became aware of the subtleties and discovered the realities. He had great love for Imam Ali, peace be upon him. Like a thirsty plant in the rain, he was inspired by him. For him, he grew, he was totally absorbed in him. Within him, the light of his heart and the rejoicing of his soul increased. He never sold his happiness to the world of affluence. One day, Imam Ali, peace be upon him, said to him, "When I am gone, you will be hanged. They will scar your body with weapons, and on the third day, your beard will be stained with the blood of your eyes and mouth. They will hang you beside the house of Amr ibn Hurayth, together with 9 others. The tree they hang you from will be the smallest. Come, I will show you the date palm from whose branch you will be hung." Then he showed Maitham the tree. The years passed, and Imam Ali, peace be upon him, was martyred. The Umayyads gained power over the people. Maitham occasionally went out to look at the tree, prayed there, and spoke to it. "O tree, may Allah bless you. I have been created for you, and you grew for me." In the year of his martyrdom, Maitham went into the precincts of the Kaaba and met Umm Salma, the wife of the Prophet. "I have heard your name from the Prophet," she said, "that he recommended you to Imam Ali, peace be upon him." Maitham asked her about Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, and learned that he had left the city. "Convey my salam to him," he said, "and tell him that it will not be long before I and he will see each other again in the next world before the Lord." Umm Salma ordered that perfume should be bought to scent Maitham's beard and then sent to him, "Soon your beard will be colored by your blood in the true way of the Prophet and his family." Maitham then went to Kufa, where 2 of Ibn Ziyad's agents arrested him and took him before the latter. This exchange took place. "Where is your God?" "Lying in wait among the oppressors, and you are one of them," said Maitham. "What did your master Ali say about you and I?" "He said you would hang me together with 9 other martyrs and that my gallows would be the shortest. I want to go against the word of your Lord, and I shall kill you in another way. How can you?" "He learned from the Prophet, and the Prophet learned from Allah. Can you go against Allah?" "I also know the place of my martyrdom, and I am the first Muslim in whose mouth they will put a bridle." Ubaidullah ibn Ziyad, his wise eyes wide open, gave the order to take him immediately to the prison. In that prison, Maitham gave Mukhtar al-Thaqafi the good news of his liberty. "You will kill Ibn Ziyad," he told him, "in revenge for the Prince of the Martyrs, Imam Hussein, peace be upon him." And so it was. Maitham was taken to the place of his sacrifice, to the place of his spiritual departure, the place from which his spirit was to soar to the highest and greatest heights of human spirituality. They hung him beside the house of Amr ibn Hurayth from that very tree that he had been shown. The people gathered around him, and on the gallows he took the opportunity to tell them of the virtues of Imam Ali, peace be upon him. He spoke and unlocked the hearts of the people, and they understood. Ibn Ziyad was informed that Maitham had defamed him, so he ordered him to be gagged so that he should be unable to speak. Then they attacked him with weapons, as Imam Ali, peace be upon him, had foretold. "Allahu Akbar," meaning "Allah is the greatest," he cried. At the end of the third day, the blood from his eyes and mouth flowed down and stained his beard. May Allah's peace be with him. Uwais al-Qarani. The Prophet said, "The scent of the heaven is wafting over from Qarani. O Uwais al-Qarani, I am eager to see you. Anyone who sees you should give you my salam." Reference: Abbas Qummi's Safina Tul Bihar, Volume 1, page 53. When everyone swore allegiance to Imam Ali, peace be upon him, at Ziqar, he said, "From Kufa, 1,000 soldiers, no more, no less, will come and swear their allegiance to me." Then they arrived, and Ibn Abbas counted them, but found only 999 persons. He was puzzled why there was one person missing. After a moment, a man came near with armor, a sword, and a shield, and the other a instruments of war. He went up to Imam Ali, peace be upon him, and said, I want to swear allegiance to you up to death and self-sacrifice. What is your name? Asked Imam Ali, peace be upon him. Uwais. Are you Uwais al-Qarni? Yes. Allahu Akbar. Allah is the greatest. My beloved Prophet, the Prophet of Allah, told me that I would meet one of his followers called Uwais al-Qarni, who was one of the party of Allah and his messenger, and who would die a martyr. A numberless group would intercede for him. Thus, it was that he was martyred in the service of Imam Ali, peace be upon him. Reference, Uzdal Ghaba, Volume 1, page 152. Uwais is well known for his spirituality as having a high position. His pleasure was worship and he had no interest in things of this world. We can learn from the sayings of Uwais the extraordinary nature of the spiritual life of this man. I swear by Allah, the thought of death and the fear and trembling at the last days leaves no place for happiness in this world for the man of faith. When we bid to good and forbid them evil, they abuse us. But with all that, we stand up for the truth of Allah. Qambar. Qambar, also one of those brave people who reached a high station by the rays of the spiritual power of the Prophet and Imam Ali alayhi salam. He did not fear to tell the truth and to seek the way of righteousness. Although in the eyes of the people of this world, he was no more than a slave in the path of spiritual stations, he was intimate to the secrets of Imam Ali, peace be upon him. The live, powerful, hard-hitting words with which this iron man replied to Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi, the bloodthirsty executioner who had the cruelty of a murderer and a criminal, have become well known. Hajjaj asked him, what was your work in the service of Ali? He replied, I made ready his water for wudu, that is the spiritual ablution before namaz or other activities. Hajjaj asked, when he had finished wudu, what did he used to say? Qambar replied, he used to recite the verse, so when they forgot what they were reminded of, we opened unto them the gates of everything until when they rejoiced in what they were doing. We seized them suddenly and behold, they were sore confounded. So the last remnant of the people who did evil was cut off. Praise belongs to Allah, the Lord of the worlds. Reference, Kitab al-Irshad, page 155. Hajjaj asked, I presume that Ayah speaks about me. Yes, said Qambar with perfect heroism. If I kill you, what can you do? Said Hajjaj. Qambar replied, I shall become a man of bliss and you a man of wretchedness. Hajjaj said, confess that you have left Ali's service. Qambar replied, if I leave his way, will I be guided to a better way? Hajjaj could not answer this question, so he said, I am your killer. Whatever way you wish, let me know and I shall kill you in this way. Qambar said, I leave that to you. Hajjaj said, why? Qambar said, because however you kill me, I shall kill you in that way in the next life. Imam Ali, my master, told me that I should be beheaded cruelly and unjustly. So Hajjaj ordered that he be beheaded. Reference, Kitab al-Irshad, page 155.